Namaste and a delightful welcome to the fourth episode of COVID Care Series by Apollo Experts. Today we have Dr. Anupam Sibal, Group Medical Director and a Pediatric Gastroenterologist, Apollo Hospitals. Professor Sibal has been working as a Group Medical Director, Apollo Hospitals Group since 2005 and as a Senior Consultant in Pediatric Gastroenterology and Hepatology at Indraprastha Apollo Delhi since 1997. Professor Sibal, acknowledged as an international expert in pediatric gastroenterology and hepatology, is an honorary clinical professor at Macquarie University, Sydney, Australia. And he has helped establish pediatric liver transplantation in India in 1998. He has about 117 publications in medical literature. He is the current president for GAPIO, a Global Association of Physicians of Indian Origin, that brings together about 1.4 million physicians of Indian origin from 54 different countries on one single platform. He's also recognized as a motivational speaker and a best-selling author. Today, he's going to talk about vaccinations, myths, and facts. Over to you, Dr. Sibal.
Good afternoon, friends. Thank you very much, Padma. We're going to be talking about something that's really uppermost on everyone's mind: vaccination, vaccination, vaccination. So let's start with some of the basics. So what is a vaccine? Vaccine is a substance which causes induction of antibodies that are capable of binding to a specific toxin or pathogen. What happens when you administer a vaccine? Basically, two types of immunity kicks in. So you have the humoral immunity. And when I say humoral immunity, I mean that the B cells that are present in the immune system secrete antibodies that cause a clearance of pathogens. We also have the cell-mediated immunity, and T cells are the effector cells for the cell-mediated immunity. And there are two types of T cells, helper cells and cytotoxic T cells. But I want to mention one point that you must always remember is that we also have memory cells. We have memory B cells and memory T cells. And it's important to recognize that should we get exposed to this virus, or for that matter, any virus or bacteria, after we've been vaccinated, our immune system, through the memory B cells and T cells, will mount an immune response to get rid of that pathogen. We cannot measure memory B cell and memory T cell response. So that's important, because when we talk about is the vaccine effective or not, we look at antibodies, we look at titers, but we forget that there are important components that we cannot measure: what the cell-mediated immunity does and what happens with memory B cells and memory T cells should an individual get exposed to that pathogen again. Herd immunity is a term that's been used quite often. So what is herd immunity? Herd immunity is immunity of a population or a community. So how can we achieve herd immunity? Well, there are only two ways. Either you get the natural infection or you get vaccinated. And of course, a natural infection, when we are talking about COVID-19, is not desirable because of the consequences. So the answer is vaccination. Now, what proportion of the population of the community should be vaccinated to achieve herd immunity? Well, in the case of measles, it's 95%. In polio, it's 80%. COVID-19, some estimates, maybe 70%, 80%, but we don't have a clear answer. Now, we all want a vaccine that's ideal. So what would an ideal vaccine look like? Firstly, we'd love to have a vaccine that's single dose, where we don't have to repeat a dose, where it gives long-term immunity. It's oral, after all, who likes injections, right? It should have high thermal stability. So, you know, it should remain efficacious when it's moved from one place to another, or when it's stored in places such as areas where the temperature goes up to 35, 40, 45, so tropical areas. It should have what we call as a multivalent vaccine, which means there should be various strains that can get covered. And of course, very importantly, it has to be cost effective. And as all of us know, who've been studying vaccination or reading about it, that the vaccine that we have against the SARS-CoV-2 virus is far from ideal. But that doesn't mean that our quest for finding the ideal vaccine will stop. We will continue to research and develop more products. But one thing that we must remember here when it comes to efficacy, and I'll be talking about it, WHO said that any vaccine that is more than 50% efficacious is good. We now have a host of vaccines that are doing way better than the WHO criteria for what is an efficacious vaccine against the SARS-CoV-2 virus. Over a period of time, everybody's become familiar with phases, phase one, phase two, phase three, phase four of clinical trials. So what do these phases mean? In phase one, there are a small number of volunteers, and the purpose here is to assess safety, confirm that the drug, or in this case, the vaccine generates an immune response, and that is judged by measuring the antibodies and also identify what is the right dose. So that's phase one. Then comes phase two, where there are several hundred volunteers, and the idea is really to assess safety and the ability to generate an immune response in a much larger population. Then comes phase three, and that's when, after phase three data, that the deployment on the ground happens. How effective is the vaccine? What is the efficacy? And here we are looking at thousands of volunteers, and what we do here is compare those who got the vaccine with those who got the placebo, which means they get an injection, but it's not a vaccine, to see what is the difference in the incidence of getting the infection over a defined period of time. And phase four, very important, and this continues for months to years, will the vaccine or the drug remain safe down the road? Now, what are the different types of vaccines? Well, we have the inactivated vaccines, where basically the pathogen is inactivated in the lab. Classical example is the polio vaccine, the Salk killed polio vaccine. Then we have live vaccines, where we use a live but a weakened version of the virus. Classical examples that everyone's familiar with, the chickenpox vaccine and the MMR, which is mumps, measles, rubella vaccine. We also have viral vector vaccines, where a virus is used to deliver the proteins. And this has been studied in medicine and also for the Ebola vaccine. And of course, as we are all now familiar with, several of the vaccines that we have against the SARS-CoV-2 virus are viral vector vaccines. Then we have the subunit approach, where either a sugar or a protein from the pathogen is used in the vaccine, and that vaccine then results in an immune response to fight the infection should it appear. The DPT, the diphtheria, whooping cough, tetanus, meningococcal meningitis are examples of the subunit approach. And then we come to the genetic approach, which is the nucleic acid vaccines. And while we are familiar with DNA vaccines, for the first time in the world, with two vaccines becoming available against the SARS-CoV-2 virus, we now have mRNA vaccines. Now, there's been a lot of excitement and a lot of work has taken place over the last 15 months in vaccine development. So currently we have 91 vaccines that are being developed, 184 that are in preclinical trials, 85 phase one, phase two trials, 26 in phase three trials. And as I mentioned, it's only after phase three that we actually deploy the vaccine on the ground in patients. And we have, in individuals, we're not talking about patients because this is a vaccine for healthy individuals. And we have 8 approved vaccines. Now, just to give you a sense of how much we know about vaccines, if you go on to PubMed, and that's where peer-reviewed medical papers are housed, there are 10,333 peer-reviewed papers on vaccination. So that's a lot of knowledge that has been accumulated over the last few months. And there isn't a day when we do not have one or more papers published on COVID vaccination. So let's just talk about something that's been on everybody's mind. You know, because the vaccines have been developed so quickly, were they rushed into? Was the study size relevant, or was it small because we didn't have time and there was pressure? So let's look at some of the vaccines that are approved for use. So let's look at the Pfizer BioNTech. The trial size here was 43,000 plus individuals. Moderna, 30,000. We look at the Astra, Oxford University, 20,000. Look at the Johnson & Johnson, 43,000 plus. Novavax, about 20,000. Covaxin, the Indian vaccine, about 25,000. Sputnik, the Russian vaccine, about 20,000. So these are very sizable populations. And to give you a sense the size of the trials, if you look at the MMR vaccine, and you know, it took several years to develop. The first measles vaccine came in 54, and then 63 came another vaccine in 68. So several years later came a sophisticated measles vaccine, and then came the MMR in 1971. But the total trial size for MMR was just 5,000. And for the chickenpox trial was 5,000. So please put your minds at rest. Basically, these vaccines have been studied in very large populations. Let's look at the efficacy of the three vaccines that are currently licensed. Two of them have been deployed in sizable numbers. Covishield, and if we look at the Covishield data based on different publications, if we look at the phase three trial data published in December, at 70.4% efficacy. We look at Covaxin, it's 80.6 in phase three. If we look at Sputnik, it's 91.6%. Now, how do you calculate efficacy? Because this is a question that's really, really, it comes up a lot. So I'm just going to take maybe a minute and explain that. So vaccine efficacy is calculated on a population basis. So we look at testing the vaccine. We have individuals who get the vaccine and we have individuals who get the placebo. Okay? Vaccine efficacy is defined as 1 minus risk ratio. So what's a risk ratio? It is the number of individuals who get an attack. So it's called an attack rate in the vaccinated population divided by those who get the attack but are unvaccinated. So let's look at Moderna. In the Moderna trial, 5 people who got the actual vaccine developed COVID as against 90 who got the placebo. So what is the risk ratio? It's 5/90. And what is the vaccine efficacy? 1 minus RR. So 1 minus 5/90, 94.4%. If we look at the Pfizer trial, 8 in those who got it, 116 the placebo group. So 1 minus 8/162, 95%. Now, this is quite different to effectiveness. When you deploy a vaccine in thousands and thousands, and then moving on to 100,000s and millions, and then, you know, going into 20 million, 50 million, 100 million, then you see what is the incidence of the infection. And that tells us about the effectiveness of the vaccine. The government of India, in a press conference on 20th April, released this data. And this is, again, very relevant for each one of us. For Covaxin, that has been deployed in 1.5 crore people, out of these, second dose was given to about 17 lakh people. Positive rate after the first dose, which was in 93 lakh, was 0.04%. And after the second was 0.04%. And Covishield, which has been used in 11.6 crore individuals, it was 0.02% after the first and 0.03% after the second dose of the vaccine. So clearly, these vaccines are very effective. And this is pretty solid data. And we are talking about more than 12 crore individuals who've been vaccinated. Now, turning to some FAQs. Are vaccines safe? Well, if they're not safe, we wouldn't want to use them, would we? So the simple answer to that question is yes. But what about thrombosis? And there's been a lot of talk about thrombosis, more so with the Astra vaccine. So the data is that the risk of thrombosis after vaccination is 5 per million. And the risk of thrombosis if you get COVID is 39 per million. So clearly the risk of getting a thrombotic complication after the disease is way higher than after getting a vaccine. If someone's taking medication, say for cancer, for diabetes, hypertension, heart disease, can one take the COVID 19 vaccine? And the answer is yes, unless of course you've had one vaccine and you're allergic, or if you have a serious history of allergy, then one needs to consider very carefully about which vaccine and some precautions need to be taken. Which lasts longer, infection or vaccination when it comes to immunity? And that's a great question. We at this point in time do not know how long the immunity lasts after a vaccination. But as time goes by, we will have more data and we'll be able to answer this question once we have data from real world conditions. how long does the immunity last after the infection? Again, we don't have a clear answer to this. What is the percentage needed for herd immunity? We don't really know this. What if I need another vaccine? Ideally, a 2 to 4 week gap, and this is a vaccine for another condition. So what if someone has had a COVID infection, recovered? Should that person take the vaccine? The answer is yes. Personal example, both my wife and I had COVID and we've taken the COVID vaccine. In those who have recovered from a natural infection, when should the vaccine be taken? There are no clear-cut recommendations. There's some European data about waiting for 3 months. Certain countries have looked at even a longer period because of availability of vaccines. But most experts would say, you know, you wait for a recovery and a few weeks after you've recovered, you should perhaps take the vaccine. But you don't have a clear timeline as we speak. What about vaccination in children? Well, we have data for the Pfizer vaccine. It's being used in children older than between 16 and 18. Our data came out between 12 and 15, very, very good results, 100% efficacy. And then we're going to get data in children between the age of 2 to 5 and older to 5. And then, of course, it'll be 6 months to 2. We will get a lot of data in the coming months and the vaccines will become available for use in children. And I know there are a lot of parents who are very concerned about vaccination for their children. We will have data and solid data in a few months. What if someone misses a dose? You shouldn't miss a dose. After all, it's an important vaccine and you know everybody's been wanting this vaccine to come in and into the market. So if you've got your appointment schedule, you shouldn't miss it. But if you missed your second dose, then please have it as soon as possible. Can you change the vaccine? Now, this is a question that has come up quite often. So you had one dose of Covishield and you want a Covaxin, or you had one Covaxin, should you have Covishield? When Sputnik becomes available in the next few weeks, there'll be this question asked. In the West, this question has been asked about using the Astra followed by a Moderna or a Pfizer or the other way around. And the answer to that is we don't have data as of now, but trials are underway. And I think in the coming weeks, we will have information about interchangeability of vaccines. Need for revaccination, the answer to that is perhaps yes, but we don't have data. Most experts believe that we will need a third dose. Will newer vaccines be needed? And the answer to that is yes. We know that this vaccine, this virus is mutating, and we've read about the South African variant. We've read about the variant from Kent. We've read about the South African variant and the variant that has been seen in certain parts of India. The variant might behave differently, and that's why we call them variants of concern. And it is very likely that we will have to have a different vaccine, a third vaccine, that will provide protection or enhanced level of protection against the mutations that we inevitably will see. When we talk about mutations, we have to realize that we have examples from the flu vaccine. Every year, the influenza vaccine changes based on the dominant mutants or the viruses that are in circulation. The WHO gives out recommendations for the strains. Then these go on to the companies, and a couple of months later, the appropriate vaccine is produced every year. And every year, this happens for influenza. So let's see what happens with COVID. But yes, the likelihood of another vaccine remains. And most experts believe that we're going to need another vaccine as time goes by. Padma, I'm going to stop there and be very happy to take any questions or any comments.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much for explaining right from the beginning of what are the types of vaccines that are available. And we've all heard about how different vaccines are in different phases, phase 1, phase 2, what happens in each one of those phases. So that was very clearly explained, sir. Thank you for that. And you also touched upon the efficacy, how WHO has defined this efficacy. The first question was how effective are these vaccines on the double mutant strains? You did touch upon that a little bit, but if you can explain that, because we are seeing a lot of different mutants in India itself. So what do you say about having the Covishield or the Covaxin, you know, people who have taken that, how well they are protected?
So, you know, this mutant that we are talking about, the double mutant or so-called double mutant, is defined as a double mutant because there were two mutations in the spike protein region. but actually there are about 14 mutations in this particular variant of concern. Only time will tell what kind of protection we get from these two vaccines, because as we have seen globally with the variants, against the South African variant, many of the vaccines have not shown as much efficacy as they have shown for the original SARS-CoV-2 wild virus, or for that matter, for the one that came out of UK and from Brazil. So only time will tell in the kind of protection. If we see more and more of this mutant here and it challenges the population that has been vaccinated, how many individuals get the infection? And this work is being done. So I think we should have data on this in the coming weeks. So the answer to that at this point in time is we don't really know.
Right. And you did talk about different types of vaccines and how doses are scheduled. So if we talk about the Covaxin and Covishield, first they said you have to have Covishield within a gap of 4 weeks. Then the guidelines were changed. If you can give some clarity between what should be the time gap between first and second dose, the recommended version.
So for Covaxin, it's very clear. It's recommended 4 weeks. For Covishield, the recommendations have varied initially from 4 weeks, and several healthcare professionals got vaccinated exactly at 4 weeks. And now the current guidelines are about 6 weeks. In certain countries, they've recommended 12 weeks. So the current recommendations in India are 6 weeks.
So the next question is, does COVID vaccine affect women's fertility?
Yeah, this is a very interesting point, and I don't know where this came from, but I think it's got something to do perhaps with mRNA and the interpretation that people have about, using a nucleic acid vaccine. So would want to put everybody's mind at rest. There is no role whatsoever the vaccine has to play in fertility. It's not just about women. This issue has come up with men as well. So please put your mind at rest. Fertility vaccination, no correlation.
On the same lines is the next question. Can it be given to immunocompromised individuals?
So again, it's a very interesting area, and some data is emerging about use in immunosuppressed, but I think we'd like to know a little bit more about immunosuppressed individuals, because traditionally someone who's immunosuppressed does not mount a good immune response to any vaccine, because you see, we're controlling the immune system to prevent rejection of the organ, or sometimes you have to control the immune system in several hematological or rheumatological conditions. So when you're controlling the immune system, it's hard for the immune system to mount an effective response to a challenge that we are producing through the vaccine. So I think we need some more data. But while talking about fertility, one point I forgot to mention, last few days one has seen this strange in the WhatsApp world about this message about periods and vaccination, which is absolutely unscientific. And I think this came up because the vaccine is now being opened up to young people. So they've been, older than 18. So there'll be girls who'll be getting vaccinated. And there was this point that was raised that, you have to wait for a few days, which again is very unscientific. So really no connection at all there.
Continuing in the same direction, doctor, can it be given to a lactating mother, a pregnant woman, or someone on blood thinners?
So you've asked me three specific questions. So let me address the first one about lactating mothers. There is no data to suggest that there is a problem with lactating mothers. But if you look at guidelines, it will the inserts from the different vaccines will say, please have a discussion with your doctor. And most doctors, and I'm a pediatrician, and I have told all my families where the mother is lactating that please go ahead and have that. The second is about pregnant ladies. Now, when the trials were done, there were several ladies who weren't aware that they were actually pregnant and they took the vaccine and they have since delivered babies. So there has been no concern in terms of someone pregnant having the vaccine. But again, if you ask me for recommendations, I think it'll take a little bit more time. But there don't seem to be any concerns. But I think the recommendations will have to wait. Now, when we talk about blood thinners, we have to look at, are we taking antiplatelet drugs? So if you're taking antiplatelet drugs, it's not a problem. If you're taking stronger anticoagulants, then one needs to have a discussion with one's doctor about should one modify the dose, should one stop, or it's all right. So it's an individual decision. But for those on antiplatelet drugs, you don't really have to worry about taking a shot.
And a couple of myths floating around, doctor. So let's clarify some of them. The first one you already touched upon, where you said COVID-19 vaccine is safe. People do think that it was developed so quickly. The researchers rushed the development of the vaccine. So its effectiveness and safety cannot be trusted. You did talk about it, but can you clarify one more time?
Yeah, let me clarify it once again that if we look at the data points in terms of the trial size, very robust. I gave you examples, chickenpox, MMR, nobody questions, 5,000 population here, upwards of 20,000 going up to 40,000. So the size of the trial, pretty substantive. I think we have access to better technology to be able to track side effects. So if there were side effects, and the reason why we even talk about thrombosis is because we have a robust mechanism globally now to pick up adverse effects that thrombosis was even picked up. But I would urge families when they are reading information that comes out in peer-reviewed publications is to please look at the whole picture. I'll give you an example. You would remember that a few months ago with the mRNA vaccine, it was reported in Norway that elderly individuals in nursing homes were dying after the vaccine. And then when an analysis was done, it showed that that many individuals, elderly individuals in nursing homes in Norway die anyway. They had got the vaccine, but when you looked at and compared with death rates, they were not any different. So similarly, when you hear of complications, one really needs to look at the larger picture and look at the data before we decide to make up our mind about can this side effect be attributed to the vaccine or not. So the answer is, we have vaccines that are way above the WHO threshold. They're a tool that we have access to protect ourselves against the SARS-CoV-2 virus. We also have to realize that while we get vaccinated, it's only one tool, and SMS remains, social distancing, masking, and sanitization. And that's something that we should not forget, because what we are also seeing is that the incidence of infection, and we know that, and we've known that for a while, that these vaccines will prevent serious complications, hospitalization, and death, which is what we want. You can get a mild infection. And we are seeing that the mild infection is seen in those vaccinated. And when you actually question them, the guard went down. They thought they've been vaccinated, so they could take their mask off and do things that they were tired of doing. So when the guard went down, the infection appeared. This is something that has been reported globally. It's been reported in India as well. So let me reiterate again, we have vaccines that are safe.
The next one is COVID-19 vaccine enters your cells and changes your DNA.
So I kind of answered that. There have been a lot of concerns about these mRNA and DNA. Nothing like that happens. Nothing. Our cell doesn't change. Our DNA is intact. Our RNA is intact.
The next one, COVID-19 vaccines must be stored at extremely lower temperatures because of the preservatives that are used in the vaccines.
So, the mRNA vaccines are the ones that really need to be stored at very low temperatures. And that's one of the concerns that many countries have shared about logistics. But if you look at the Covaxin or the Covishield vaccines, then it's standard for all other vaccines. Sputnik also has some requirements that are more than Covishield and Covaxin. So each a vaccine comes with its own storage and transport criteria that have to be strictly followed.
Natural immune system is better than vaccine immunity.
Yeah, so the natural immune system is you get the infection. So I want to ask how many of us will volunteer? Hey, listen, there's this individual in front of me who has COVID-19. I'm going to take my mask off and go next to that person and say, hey, cough on me. Right? That's how you get natural infection, right? Now, you could do that in the olden days with chickenpox and measles because you knew that there won't be any serious consequences. But with COVID-19, you could actually die. So you wouldn't want to risk getting a natural infection. So the only option for us to develop immunity logically, scientifically, in a safe manner is vaccination.
So the next question what we have is, doctor, can the vaccination be taken by a couple planning for children?
The answer to that is yes.
I have comorbidity. Last year, I suffered from COVID. This year, completed second dose of Covishield. Am I in a safe position or I still have a chance to get infected again?
I would have loved to say that you're in a safe position. So my answer is you are in a safer position than for someone who's not been vaccinated, because sadly, we have now begun to see individuals who've had COVID infection and have caught a repeat infection, and some of them have even been vaccinated. So you can't really let your guard down, but I can promise you this much based on the data that we have. God forbid you get it, it will be mild, and it will be something that you won't have to worry about, and your body will fight it very well. But you aren't really safe. You are safer.
One more question, doctor. What is a good time for vaccination for a person who got COVID in the past?
Yeah, again, it's a very interesting question. I would wait for a few weeks, after you've recovered. So maybe 4 weeks or so, but like there isn't a crystal clear guideline. Some countries have given a longer leeway saying like do it after 90 days or so, but a few weeks after the recovery from the natural infection would seem like a logical time to get vaccinated.
That concludes our question and answer session, doctor. It was a really insightful session into vaccination myths and facts. You clarified a lot of myths floating around. Thank you so much for that. So do watch us out for the next session tomorrow at the same time. Topic is medical management of COVID-19 by Dr. Sai Praveen Harnat, pulmonologist at Apollo Hospitals. If you do have any more queries, please do reach us out through the Facebook Messenger or post in the comment section. Until then, take care. Be safe. As Dr. Sibyl mentioned, don't forget to SMS. S for social distancing, M for mask always on, S is for sanitization. And thank you. Namaste.